the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham was the father of Isaac, who was the father of Jacob, who was the father of Judah and his brothers, who was the father of Perez and Zerah, whose mother was Tamar, who was the father of Hezron, the father of Ram, the father of Amminadab, the father of Nashon, of Salmon, of Boaz, whose mother was Rahab. Boaz was the father of Obed, whose mother was Ruth. Obed the father of Jesse, who was the father of David, the greatest king of Israel. David was the father of Solomon, who was the father of Rehoboam, the father of Abijah, of Asa, of Jehoshaphat, of Jehoram, of Uzziah, of Jotham, of Ahaz, of Hezekiah, of Manasseh, of Ammon, of Josiah, and Josiah the father of Jeconiah and his brothers at the time of the exile to Babylon. After the exile to Babylon, Jeconiah was the father of Zerubbabel. Zerubbabel was the father of Abiud, the father of Eliakim, of Azor, of Zadok, of Akim, of Eliud, of Eleazar, of Mathan, who was the father of Jacob, and Jacob the father of Joseph, the husband of Mary, of whom was born Jesus, who is called the Christ. Thus, there were 14 generations in all from Abraham to David, 14 from David to the exile to Babylon, and 14 from the exile to the Christ. This is how the birth of Jesus Christ came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be with child through the Holy Spirit.
God's greatest social network. That's what I want to share with you today. Obviously goes well with our theme, God's social network, the Bible. Now, don't get confused when you see that title of our theme for the year. The Bible is not God's social network. The Bible reveals God's social network. The Bible is part of God's social media, right? There's a difference between social media and social network. The media is the method of delivering a message. The network is how, what those messages are about, who they are for, and so on and so forth. Today I want to share with you God's greatest social network that we see in the Bible. But I want to start this message out with a really depressing story. And then I want to end the message with a really depressing story. And I know that's why you came to church today. You woke up and you thought, I want to go to church and I want to get really depressed. I want the pastor just to make me feel depressed so that when I walk out of church, I walk out with my head hanging low and feeling miserable. Isn't that what? No? Well, that's what we're going to do, sort of. I'm going to start and end with kind of depressing stories. The first one happened in part to me a number of years ago. I was pastoring in Urbana, Ohio, First Baptist Church, and I was called to go and do a graveside funeral service. you are pulling out your phone with a calculator. Okay? Do the best you can. Think about how many people that is in basically your immediate biological family, or adoption as well, that kind of thing. Okay? How many people you got? So, if you have a family of 10 or fewer people, would you please sit down? Notice there are about 3 or 4 people who sat down. 20 or fewer. Okay, I'm sitting down. 30 or fewer. Starting to drop like flies now. Look around. Look at these people who have family, right? Lots of family. 40 or fewer. Couple. 50 or fewer. Wow. 60 or fewer. partial line of strength. The second is like it. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. That love would be expressed through a social network, not in isolation, beginning with a husband and wife, followed by them having children, and thus God creating his greatest social network, family. Now, the family was not only God's idea, it was the absolute essential element for having his creation work. Think about it. If that family didn't work, then their creation would have ceased to be. Unfortunately, that original couple decided that they knew better than God, or at least believed they could know as much as God, which was the temptation, right? Genesis 3, 4 through 5. You will not surely die, the serpent said to the woman. For God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will become open, and you will become like God, knowing good and evil. That was the temptation. They decided they knew better than God. That even though God had this plan for family, they thought they had a way of doing things that was better than God had planned. How many of you have ever read the book, The Shack? Raise your hand up. How many of you have yet seen the movie? Five of us have seen it. I don't very often give a blanket, go see this, but go see this. Go see it. It gives a great picture of the Trinity. It really helps us kind of get a sense of the Trinity, I think, unlike anything I've ever read or looked at. But one of the big things in that movie or in the book is that the central character thinks he knows better than God, right? That he knows how things should work better than God, that how other people should be and how circumstances should fall into place better than God, and God sets him straight over time, gives him a chance to figure it out. Well, so Adam and Eve, they did this, and they fell into temptation. They gave way, and they sinned, and once they decided that they could make a better plan than God, all hell broke loose. Literally, all hell broke loose. But even that didn't change God's original centerpiece of life, the family. When all hell broke loose, God decided to start over. And so he chose a righteous family, a husband and his wife, their three sons and their wives. This righteous family is going to start all over. Without that family, the flood would have been the end of the story. But even when that family messed up later on, God did not waver from his original design. Family has remained essential and center we are as human beings. What does that mean for the lady in my depressing story? a male and female? Why come together? Why family? Why not just a whole bunch of individuals that can go ahead and live in isolation or live any way they want to? Why this whole thing of family? Why not just forget male and female, husband and wife, parents and children, siblings, grandparents, aunts, uncles, cousins? Just create us all out of dirt. The answer to that question, for the same reason he created you and me, as distorted, dysfunctional, and sinful as we are, here's the good news. God is able to redeem his creation.
Amen.
He can take what is broken and fix it. He can take what is unsalvageable and save it. God can make right what we have made wrong. God can take each individual, no matter their natural situation, and make them part of the greatest social network possible, the family of God. And there is no shortage of brothers and sisters. There are no people in isolation in the kingdom of God. The flawed earthly family serves as a shadow of the perfected family of God. The word family denotes that people are a part of the same bloodline, and if not blood, part of the same love line, as in adoption. Those who are a part of God's family all have the same bloodline, right? In Jesus Christ, we have the same bloodline, and in Jesus Christ, we have the same love line, both of which come through Christ on the cross. His blood shed, and the fact that he showed the full extent of God's love. And so, as members of the family of God, we share the same bloodline and the same love line. Okay, told you we're going to start with the depressing story and end with the depressing story. The first depressing story was a story that I was a part of. The second depressing story, it's not my story. I'm going to read you a Facebook post. Okay? Now we're in our social media, so that's appropriate for us with this theme. And this is a woman who wrote this post. And I'm just going to simply read her words to you so you can picture yourself looking at Facebook. If you've never done that, just picture yourself looking at your phone or computer screen. And there's this thing where basically you can write something and it shows up. And here really have that. I don't have a single picture of me with family or even a single picture of my mother. I only have 3 pictures of me during my childhood years. Again, this is not a pity party. I just needed to give some background. I've never let my childhood stand in the way of accomplishing goals. I graduated from college. I work in a lab. I've been promoted to supervisor. When people meet me, they have no idea that I had a horrible childhood because, as I was well trained, I am always the life of the party. This has left me in a weird position in life. I had a horrible upbringing, but never once strayed from the straight and narrow. Never did drugs, alcohol, wasn't promiscuous. Seemed like the exact opposite of many that survived this kind of severe abuse. I just saw what I didn't want to be and never lived my life like that. Although I'm a normal functioning member of society, I still feel like I live outside the glass snow globe. I feel like I have my face pressed against the glass and am watching everyone else live their lives. Many of the conversations I can't participate in, like funny things my mom, dad, sister, brother, etc. said or did. I don't even have an emergency contact. Dating has been a joke. I was never taught body language of the opposite sex, so I've never understood the rules of flirting or of picking up signals. It doesn't help that I now live in Los Angeles. For anyone who doesn't know what that means, most people here only judge others based solely on their stereotype, as I had to find out the hard way. So, since I am black, it makes dating here impossible. Living outside the glass snow globe also means you don't have anyone who understands. Don't talk about this often because most of the people I know never had to deal with abuse. The few times I do, the only thing they would say is, hey, don't worry. You're going to find some great guy someday. Don't get me wrong. I do want that. And yes, it would be nice to find someone to make me feel special, since I've never experienced that before growing up. But this is way deeper than that. I've never had a birthday party. I don't know what it's like to have a holiday with family. Sure, people invite me over for family functions, but that only makes me feel worse because I'm only an observer watching someone else's family traditions. While the people who invite me are patting themselves on the back for their good deed for the day, I'm left wondering what is worse, spending a holiday alone or being somewhere that is a constant reminder of what I never had. Most important, Jesus and said, I can tell you're from God. And Jesus knew what he needed, not why he came, but Jesus knew what he needed, and that was to be born again. He says, Nicodemus, unless you are born again, you cannot enter the family of God. He used the word the kingdom of God. You must be born of the water and of the Spirit. Every human being is born of the water. We must say, my water broke, and the baby is born. Every human being is halfway to heaven, but can't quite get there unless you are reborn, born again, of the Spirit. Are we doing everything we can, brothers and sisters, to be fruitful and multiply and increase in number God's family? God made it very clear. He said, I want you to come over to family dinner. And I've set out invitations, so would you go let people know that it's time to come to my dinner? And the servants went out, and they came back with excuses from the people. He said, well, then go and invite the lame, the deaf. Invite everybody you see. They did, and some people came and said, God, there's still more. There's still more people out there, and there's still more room in your family. There's more room at your table. Then go and compel them to come in. Beg them. Let them know what this means to you, that you are part of the family of God. Don't sit back and let them stay outside the snow globe of my family. Let's pray. Lord God Almighty, give us a heart, a desire to know that people matter to you, that you want us to all be brothers and sisters. And yes, Lord, even in your family on this earth, we are going to have some dysfunction, and we're going to have some things that don't work right because we are those flawed human beings. But your eternal family is perfect, and when we come to you, we do become a part of that as well. And I thank you, God, for every person here who's gotten inside that God's family snow globe. And Lord, I thank you for everybody here who is outside looking in right at the moment. And I pray that they've heard enough of the message today, that their heart is stirred and their mind is beginning to believe, and they want to confess their sin and say, God, I need you. I can't do this on my own. Come into my heart. I believe that you are who you say you are. Lord, don't let anybody leave this place today without having put their trust in you and you alone and having become a part of the great family of God. Lord, it goes all the way back to that text that we started with, from Matthew, that lineage of Jesus, where the baby Jesus is born, and he's placed in a manger. But God, you didn't leave him in a manger. You sent him to the cross. You sent him to the cross where his bloodline would be made available to all who believe. And in that, he showed the full extent of his love. We pray in his name. Amen. If you are not a believer in Jesus Christ, and today, he, not me, he, it means the Holy Spirit has been talking to you, has made you a believer. You say, you know, I'm not sure, I've gone to church some, but I've never really put my trust in Jesus, and today is that day that you are ready to do that. We ask prayer team members to come to both sides down here, and you can come down to either side and say, I need Jesus in my life, would you pray with me? Teach me how to pray, to ask Jesus into my heart, and they'll do it. If you've been worshiping with us and you want to join in membership in this church, come and let them know, and they'll say a prayer for you. If you have somebody you know who's standing outside that snow globe and you want prayer for them, come and ask them to pray with you for that person. Let's stand and sing. Come. Glory be to God, who by his mighty power at work within us is able to do far more than ever dare to ask for or dream of. Infinitely beyond our highest prayer